And now, a math lesson. Let's say the Zaxby's chicken finger plate comes with 4, 5, or 6 hand-breaded fingers and one side of Zax sauce. Plus, you can try them with Zax sauce, honey mustard, hot honey mustard, tongue torch, teriyaki, wimpy nuclear barbecue ranch, sweet and spicy, insane. How many possible combinations does that make? Carry the 2 with the remainder. A lot. Zaxby's chicken finger plate. The sauceabilities are endless.
From Tally to Cali,
it's time to wake up!
Wake up! Warchant.com is your ultimate Seminole sports source.
And this is Wake Up Warchant, presented by Zaxby's.
Now here's Warchant.com's Azan Hunjavandi
and Corey Clark.
Wake up! What's up, everybody? It's Wake Up Warchant, proudly presented by Zaxby's. Indescribably good listening to us on YouTube. Thank you very much. Go ahead and hit the thumbs up button if you're listening to us on iTunes. 5-star review would be much appreciated. Warchant.com, ultimate Seminole sports source, that is. Warchant 30 is the promo code. Corey Clark's here, everybody. Rejoice. What's up, Corey? How are you, man?
I thought you were going to start reading off 5-star reviews, at least occasionally.
Yeah, I thought we'd do like on the fifth day of the month. That way, it was the first of the month. Can you believe it? Crazy.
It's crazy.
It's February. Made it.
I know.
216 days away from the opener against Notre Dame, by the way. So, yeah, that's pretty cool, right?
Yeah, it is. We're getting there, man. We're slowly but surely.
I can't believe it's already February, man. I'm going to try.
I can't believe it's 2021. I mean, that's nuts.
Dude, I texted you this the other day, and Ira. I went, I think, the first 2 shows of the year, so the way I upload every show, I date it, so that way people know which, you know, it's a new show, old show. And the first 2 shows of the year I properly labeled as, you know, whatever, January, whatever, 2021. Man, I went a good 3 weeks where I put everything as 2020. Nobody said a word.
Yeah.
Not one person. Not one subscriber on Warchant. Not one podcast. It's crazy.
Well, we all want to keep living in 2020. We're not willing to admit that we've moved on to another year.
Oh man. So I wanted to learn this year how to hit a speed bag. Like boxing speed bag, just cuz growing up watching Rocky, it's the coolest thing ever, right? And I don't know. I don't really have anywhere all that idea. I mean, I rent this house. I don't know if I want to, you know, start drilling into studs and hanging up these huge contraptions. I think I'm gonna graduate up to. I think I want to learn how to do a handstand, get agile, my inner. Because man, I played tennis against Ira on Saturday, and my body's broke down. Right, I'm hurting.
Yeah.
And I don't know. I just got to get more limber or something. Corey, what are you up to these days? What can I do to feel like you?
I mean, I'm not doing handstands. I guess I should start. I haven't really thought about that. I'll run up my stairs a few times a day. Uh-huh. Try to get the heart racing a little bit, get a little cardio, and that's about it. I sit on my couch.
That's like that's Walter Payton-esque stuff right there, like the running.
Well,
up
I'm more like Jerry Rice. Like, I don't have a hill really by my house, so I just run up the stairs. I mean, the work that I'm putting in, you're talking about 2 or 3 minutes a day of just heart racing stuff. Which again, this body's not an accident. You've seen it.
Yeah.
This work comes into this. This was not just given to me.
Redbeard actually left the most recent 5-star review. Corey and Aslan hold it down for all Noles fans on this pod. Great information, entertainment, all in one on this podcast. If you're a true Noles fan, this is the podcast for you. 5-star he left.
There you go. Man, and we could have written that better ourselves.
Shout out TDon195. Wake Up Warchant is how he labeled it. 5-star review. You guys are like having a comfortable conversation on all things FSU. Not only informative, but enjoyable entertainment. And there's somebody even 3-star or 3 reviews back that went 5-star. And then somebody left a 4-star review, said, it's all right, but left a 4-star review. So that's all right. D-Wade.
Oh, hey, we'll take it. Hey, man, you'll take a few all right 4-stars, won't you?
Yeah.
We know.
Yeah. So, all right, nonetheless, we proceed with the show for today. Signing day coming up on Wednesday. So when we have our live show Tuesday, maybe we'll tack on something from Michael Langston on the back end of it, but... I think Tywan Malone, Destin Hill, those are still pretty much the only 2 guys in play for Florida State. Check out warchant.com for the latest on recruiting with Michael Langston. You wrote a real good column, Corey, after the schedule dropped, talking about how you're not going to be our Huckleberry.
Yeah.
You're not going to do the dubs and the L's for 2021 right now in January, or February, rather. It's February, Aslan. So.
It's also 2021.
It is 2021.
Yeah.
It's crazy. So my question to you then is, and I understand it, that's your prerogative. You can do that. And you weren't telling people not to partake in this yearly exercise of guessing wins and losses before we even see a depth chart or see what happens in spring football. My question to you, though, Corey, is the crux of it is just kind of, hey, the uncertainty. Like, you kind of throw your hands up in the air like, hey, man, I've got no idea what this team's going to look like. Neither do any of you, so I'm not going to undergo in this exercise. So then I ask you kind of, well, you didn't have that much trepidation doing it in 18, right? No. Or like 19. So like, I can say with Jimbo, we kind of knew where we were going to be maybe after 11. Like, did you know what 2010 was going to look like? Would you, if we would have been doing this show in 2010, do you think you would have felt comfortable picking wins and losses? Or is it just, it's a whole different world?
Yeah, yes, because even that 09 season, as bad as it was, you thought, okay, well, if they had a full coaching staff that was all dedicated to one thing and not, you know, basically three guys ready to retire, and they were still 7-6 in 09, yes, they should take a step up. Not a huge one, and they didn't. But they took a nice step.
Oh, that's I thought that's a huge step, man.
Well, 7-6 to 10-4. I mean, yeah, fine. They lost two less games, and one of those wins was on a 55-yard field goal. So they it just looked better, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you know what I mean. And they blew some teams out or played really well against some teams. But they also in 09, other than Florida, I don't remember them getting blown out. Other than, you know, they lost to USF. Great USF team, and Florida crushed them. Other than that, it was a bunch of, you know, Fortson dropping a pass in the end zone, and Boston College losing in the rain, throwing for 400 yards, whatever the case may be. So I think I had a better, and plus you had Ponder coming back. I think I had a better idea on that team.
And you beat BYU, and you took it to BYU.
That's right, man. And you scored two touchdowns against Jacksonville State in the rain to put that one away, showing some heart. So I just felt like, yeah, I had a better idea, and Jimbo had been here. We knew what the offense was going to be. I believed in him as a coordinator for sure. And, yeah, it worked out to be obviously a much better program in a couple of years. This one was more like, I don't want to pick wins and losses because, again, what do we know? It's February. But it also was like, look, you have to be encouraged by what you've seen. And basically, I don't want people to think I'm like a glass half empty kind of guy, but we have to be realistic. I mean, I know some people want to say, oh, they could win 8 or 9 games. Sure, they could also win 3. There's a wide disparity here on this. The spectrum is pretty big when it comes to Florida State football in 2021, in my opinion, because we just don't know. But what you're seeing from Norvell in the off season, and again, the off season is the off season. We want to get good in the on season. You know what I'm saying? We want to report and watch an on-season winner, not an off-season winner. But for the off-season, what he's done and the momentum he seems to be building, and they got another commitment that I'm sure we'll talk about on Sunday, man, that's important stuff. That's important, and it's encouraging. But it's not going to have me picking them to win 8 games. They just don't know.
Well, I mean, what did we know in 18?
Nothing. I was completely wrong. That's part of the reason I don't want to do it. I'm always wrong. I thought after 17 they lost all those games, but they were close in all of them but Boston College. And they finished on a 4-game winning streak. A lot of that team was coming back. The offense was supposed to be more dynamic and faster, and it was not. But we didn't know that in August. We didn't know that in February when the schedule was released.
Scoring 40 touchdowns and scrimmages and things like that.
Yeah, like that. And you're like, man, they might win. They have a chance to win 9 or 10 games. It's an easy schedule. And then before you know it, they're 1-3 or whatever they were. And, you know, so I try to get out of the prediction business. But I do, again, I like what – I don't want that to mean that I think they're going to be 3-9.
Right.
Or they're not worth – picking W's and L's for. I just think we have no idea. So much of the team is going to be new, but also I do like what Norvell's doing. Both can be true. I can like what he's doing and still think he might win 6 games in 2021.
What's the biggest single variable that makes you uneasy or you think is the biggest sort of question mark? Is it what this team can look like with a healthy, productive, fully developed quarterback at the helm that has, you know, 30-plus games maybe under his belt, has won a national championship? or and we don't know what his health is going to be. We're hearing good things. Obviously, everything checks out, but ultimately we got to see what happens when rubber hits the road. Or is it that defense was just so bad last year that even with some of these new additions, there's still that hesitancy to make your mind wander into a world where, man, this defense actually may be pretty good because of just how bad they were. Is it the quarterback or the defense, the unknown there, that has you kind of the most puzzled?
Absolutely the defense. I'm going into next season not having seen McKenzie Milton throw anything. Haven't seen him throw a fit, a tantrum, a football, none of it. I'm going into next season thinking the offense will score 32, 34 points a game. I feel like they'll average somewhere in that neighborhood, maybe a lot more, maybe 8 points more than that. Maybe they'll be one of the higher scoring teams in the conference. But I have, and maybe it's foolish, but I have complete confidence in that offensive staff with McKenzie Milton, with the running backs, with hopefully better receiver play, that they can put up 4 or 5 touchdowns a game. I have no idea about the defense. I didn't see, like on offense, we saw some signs, right?
Yes.
We saw some flashes. They were brief, quite brief. But we saw some flashes at least. I didn't see jack squat from the defense at all. The only flashes we saw from the defense at all in 2020 came from a cornerback that's no longer on the team. Like, there was just nothing redeeming about it. So that's where my concern is. Now, they could be a lot better. If they get to even be like we've talked about, like be top 60 in the country, take that kind of jump. Go from 108 to 66th. I think that's probably 2 extra wins. And I think you can have an offense that once or twice this next season can be good enough to win like that game against Duke, where you just outscore a team. They just can't keep pace with you. I think there is a chance you could have that. But to make any real noise and to double your win total or triple it, which is quite a high goal. But if you get 8 wins, your defense is going to have to take a big step. It can't be 108th in the country. It can't be 95th in the country and expect to, with that schedule, to win 8 games. You just give yourself so little room for error. When you know you're going into a game going to give up 5 or 6 touchdowns, whether it's Trevor Lawrence playing quarterback or Bailey Hockman, you're going to give up 6 touchdowns. And you can't go into games like that. So hopefully, look, whole offseason, I think a better collection of players from top to bottom, more experience. I think there's a chance they could be improved, but they better be, or it's going to be it could be a long season. But hey, we're in February. We still got we got 7 more months of this.
Speaking of McKenzie Milton, I don't know if you saw this on the internet. I'm going to play this for you, Corey. This is him interacting with Amari Gaynor. Maybe you can help translate.
Boy, yeah. Throw them thin bands on. Whoop. Woo! Without Uno, yes sir.
I got yes sir out of that, and Uno. Amari's wearing number 1 for a photo shoot. I don't know what happened to him and Eriser, but can you hear? What did he say?
Throw them thin bands on. Whoop.
Throwing them dams on. Whoop.
Who is talking?
Woo! McKenzie Milton.
Was that Uno?
Yes, sir. That's our guy. It's McKenzie Milton.
He knows his name. That's a positive, right? Like, he's getting to know his teammates. And it's not like that's a guy he throws to. It's a guy on the different side of the ball, and he knows him. So that's good.
I didn't even think about that.
Yeah.
That's good.
The only reason I thought about it was because the transfers last week, a few of them, but when we talked to them, were talking about, I still got to get to know all the players on the team. Get to know their names and all that. Because, you're coming into a team with 60 guys that you don't know. It's not easy to remember them all in a week.
So I feel like I'm thieving at the show Fell Shop of optimism, because I think that's going to be – I think Ira's sort of focus right now is just synergy and leadership and what a guy like that can do for your locker room if he is just a very well-liked, respected guy in the locker room that also happens to be a very supremely talented and gifted position, or rather, what would I say position player for? Quarterback.
Right.
I was trying to grab my paper. By the way, James Blackman's going to Arkansas State.
I saw that. It's not that's a pretty decent landing spot for him. You feel like he has a chance to play there?
Yeah, I thought he was going out west. I thought he was going Mountain West.
Well, look, Arkansas State's not bad.
Oh, poor guy. I mean, I really do wish nothing but the best for him. Just I can't – like Jonesboro, Arkansas, to me, just does not strike me as being one of the more entertaining, uplifting – I have a buddy that actually works at a TV station out there. Met his wife there and moved to Jackson, Mississippi, and they were so eager to move back to Jonesboro. So maybe I'm selling it short, but it just – it's out there, man. I mean, Arkansas is the wild – Arkansas is kind of out there by itself. And then Jonesboro within Arkansas is just – you know.
Hey, but you know what? He got to be a Florida State quarterback for 4 years.
He beat the Gators of the Swamp.
But either way, he still just got to be the Florida State quarterback for 4 years. Now, it might not have been the best experience the last 2 years, but still, overall, it beats probably not being the Florida State quarterback if you're just a regular student on campus. So, you know, he still got to live that life a little bit. Now he's going to see, you know, how the other half lives. And also, he must really love football. And I don't think we ever questioned that about him anyway. But to go there to continue your career, that says something about how much he loves football. And maybe ends up being a coach one day.
Well, I don't know if you can hear that, Corey. I got a piece of paper in my hand. I had the depth chart from the Georgia Tech game. Defense: Josh Kando, Marvin Wilson, Robert Cooper, Janaris Robinson. So three of those four are gone.
Hey, how did any of them do in the Senior Bowl? I didn't get to see any of it.
Marvin did not play.
Oh.
Unsure why. Janaris had a sack.
Okay, J-Rob. Mm-hmm. All right. Kando did not. Was Kando there?
I don't know. I never saw anything about Kando being there.
Yeah, I know. So. You know, it was all – it's funny. It was always Janaris retweeting it. But there were people saying a lot of nice things about him on Twitter. About – during the week, I mean. Like some of the moves he made during the week and the scrimmage portions of the Senior Bowl. And then he had a sack in the game, so maybe maybe he'll get drafted. Maybe his stock's going up. Maybe he'll be a third-day guy.
Maybe, yeah, I would say, be like the most surprising Florida State professional career since, like, Lavernius Coles, Antone Smith. Just somebody there like, you know. And then, they have a career.
Yeah, there's a few like that, right? That when you think back, you're like, wow, that guy's still in the league. He made a nice living.
Orpheus Roy kind of had that, no?
I would say Andre Fluellen, too.
Yeah.
Oh, flu season?
That's right.
Because, you know, he was nice at Florida State. He was a pretty good player, but you wouldn't have thought I think he was in the league for almost a decade or like 8 years or something, which I wouldn't have thought that. And then also LaTroy Guyon.
Yes.
Was another guy that didn't play you don't remember him starring at Florida State, but he played in the league a good while too.
Yeah, I think he got a big time paycheck too. Although I think he got cut maybe in the middle of it. So
hey, well, what can you do?
7 years in the league for Andre Fluellen.
Okay,
Cartersville. Nice. I know he's from Cartersville. Shout out.
Yeah, it's Trevor Lawrence's hometown.
That's
right.
That's right. Also Butch Walker. He's
And their nickname for their high school is the Purple Hurricanes.
Really.
Yeah, there you go. A little trivia. Yeah, again, you guys tune in to learn stuff. Yeah. And now if somebody ever asks you if you're at a bar, when we go back to bars, well, I'm sure some of you have already, and somebody says, hey, do you know what Cartersville High's nickname is? Now you know. It's the Purple Hurricanes. So you're welcome.
Hamsa's the guy I forgot about. Hamsa played two tackles.
Okay.
Started, so.
All right.
We'll see what happens. I saw somebody, I think the Houston Chronicle did a story on Marvin because he was out there, and they quoted some anonymous scout that was just like, you know, he's mean and fast. He's the kind of guy you want on your front seven in the NFL. So we'll see how that goes.
Yeah, he could. I certainly wouldn't project him being a first round pick, but you feel like he could sneak somewhere into the second day.
Yeah. Not a lot of people bullish on him though on the boards. They don't think he performed all that well. Also, he was quoted in that same story about everybody he was interviewed by brought up the tweet, and he said that he did not handle it the way he should have. So there's
that. Marvin said that.
Yeah. So he's sorry, everybody. You all win. You shamed the kid. Good for
well,
you.
Well, again, I you know, it was such a – man, that week in particular, it was so – with Drew Brees and – like Drew Brees had happened that day, I think, who was his good receiver?
Michael Thomas
was like calling him out. You know, that had happened that day. And then obviously what else was going on in the summer, and then that happens, and you're like, oh, you know, obviously. And, you know, Shanna, my ex-wife, is a a huge Florida State fan and a really big Marvin Wilson fan, and is, you know, I won't even get into that. But she even asked, like, why did he have to tweet about it? Couldn't he have just gone to the coach and said something?
Yeah, he said he should have handled it in-house.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right, continuing on, though.
Oh, you don't want to go back into that?
Nah. It's February. Maybe in April.
You
want to
talk about COVID?
Yeah, maybe in April.
Okay.
So, Kando, Marvin, Coop, Janaris.
Okay.
So, Coop's still there. And I think we both like Coop. I like Coop. Yeah. I don't want to speak for I like Coop.
Yep.
Ericer, Leonard Warner, Amari Gaynor. They're all back.
Yep. At different positions, apparently, except for Ericer.
Yeah, bringing the whole band back there. And then Asante, gone. Renardo Green, Jaden Lars Woodby, Jarian Jones.
Okay.
Those are the guys. Those are the gentlemen that started against Georgia Tech.
Yeah.
I mean.
Look, and also think about, you know, Marvin wasn't Marvin. Like, I'm not saying that Fabian Lovett will end up being a better defensive lineman than Marvin Wilson in 4 years or even next year. But last year he was. You know, and you got him coming back. Keir Thomas is better than anybody else you just listed, I think, in my opinion, because you weren't getting the Marvin that we thought we were going to get. So it just seems like an upgrade. Other than Asante, you're not losing a whole lot, and you're getting better. Like, Jamie Robinson is an upgrade from Jaden Lars Woodby.
Yes.
You know, I don't even know that that's debatable. I guess we'll see. Maybe he'll break out at Boston College, but it doesn't seem debatable. So, yeah, you read that and you're like, okay, all right. I can see where it was. It's you can see some positive steps being made.
Yeah, because I'm just trying to put myself back into like 26-year-old, 16-year-old Aslan shoes about like, dreaming and looking at the season ahead and thinking of positive things, but then also realistic, practical Aslan that also wants to censure people that are like, yeah, 9 wins. So, there's reasons. I don't know. I'm at the point where I'm more apt to believe in guys I haven't seen anything from than the whole, like, well, it's year better. You know, they'll be a year better. You know, see, so they get better over a year. I get it. But I saw what they looked like a year ago.
Yeah.
I'd rather.
Well, the unknown, too, right? The
unknown
sometimes can be more appealing than what you already know. And we know some of those guys just weren't either good fits or good football players or both. But we know what they weren't doing at Florida State.
And I think somebody commented either on the video or maybe a story that on the forums after the schedule dropped just about, I mean, they weren't making a win-loss prediction, but just said something like, I think like this season's going to be very intriguing, which sounds kind of generic, but that's where I'm at. I think there's so many things in play here, whether it's how bad last year was and whether or not you want to factor in COVID and all the stipulations and regulations from that into affecting the way the season plays. Just with all these new guys going and using the portal and trying to do the free agency route, and how do you judge growth from that season to this season? It's going to be a blast, I think, man, really. We're going to have fun on the show, I think.
I'm excited, man. It's going to be a lot to talk about. A lot of new faces, a lot of big games. Hopefully, if Mackenzie Milton's good, man, that'll be fun just to watch that. Even if they're losing games 41-40, they'll still be fun to talk about.
How fun would it have been to talk about Georgia Tech in 2009?
The team or that game?
That game.
Oh, like I don't know, man. It was pretty gross.
If that's our barometer, we're gonna be.
Yeah,
talking
that
about
was different though, because
games.
it was just the offense they were running. Like they had literally. I don't think Georgia Tech punted that game. I think they had the ball 8 times or 7 times and scored 6 touchdowns and a field goal, and they just could not stop them. So that was a little disheartening just to watch and be like, yeah, and it doesn't portend anything because it's that one stupid offense. But you know, with these games, I'll get you know, if they lose to NC State 41-38, that would be obviously you'd probably be pretty depressed by that. But at least it would be entertaining, more entertaining than the last NC State game.
You're right. Looking to buy a home? Who isn't? First, though, you'll need someone in your corner, so turn to the experience and savvy of Home Financial Group. Home Financial Group offers products for any prospective buyer, whether FHA, VA, conventional, or commercial loan, and hard money for investors looking to generate wealth. Get a hold of Ryan. He's a Noles, 954-358-9247, 954-358-9247, and his team can put together a fully documented pre-approval so you can search with total confidence. NMLS number 1314679, Sunrise, Florida. Looking ahead, guess who's number 5 in the nation for recruiting? Class of 2022, as you seal up your Diet Pepsi.
Or sorry about that. Is it
Fanta? What'd you go with? Diet Pepsi?
No, I don't ever drink Fanta. Are you crazy? I drink Diet Sunkiss, but okay. I don't go that Fanta route. That's nuts.
What about, is there Diet Crush? Does Crush make Diet?
I don't think so. I mean, everybody would have to, you would think, but I've never had one. I've never seen one. But yeah, they might. But it was a Diet Pepsi. Florida State's number 5 in the recruiting rankings right now. And
2022.
Very, very early.
Yes.
But again, isn't that on the heels of what they did with in the transfer portal? Maybe, I guess we think they're at least going to get one more signee here in a couple days. And then, so on the heels of that, then they get this quarterback from Arizona.
Nico.
Who apparently, say his name for all of them.
I don't know what his last name. I don't know how to pronounce his last name, so let's call him Nico. I think it's Marchio. I don't know if the L is silent or not. It could be Marchiole or just Marchio. I've only heard it pronounced once on YouTube by a Arizona prep newspaper writer, and he said Marchio.
So without the L?
Yes.
Okay, so they've tapped back into that Arizona quarterback pipeline and gotten another one, but he's a 4-star kid, right? Like top 100, 200 kid, something?
Rivals 250.
Yeah. So a good player.
Yes.
And again, if you were on Twitter and you were watching like the likes of Travis Hunter tweeting about that and other people, even Darius Washington who's on the team, you feel a little bit of energy now, man, with this thing. Now, they're not going to probably finish 5th in the country. Eventually, Alabama's going to start getting more commitments. But having someone like Travis Hunter is an enormous deal. Because, you know, again, it's not February of 2022 yet. He hasn't put pen to paper or, you know, he hadn't put in his fax machine number yet. So it's not official. But having Travis Hunter in that class, it speaks to other kids that might be on the fence about whether they want to go to a program that's in the middle of a rebuild. And you're like, well, look, man, we got the best player in the country coming here. He's not afraid. Why would you be afraid? Plus, I just think when you see there is a such thing as momentum in recruiting, right? I do believe in that. Yeah. And I think when you see guys like the kid in Arizona committing, Travis Hunter being apparently the firmest of commits and isn't wavering, again, we'll see. But you have these guys already on board, and you can show these recruits that you're working on, look where we are, man. You're not coming to an empty cupboard. We have the 5th-ranked recruiting class in the country right now. So be a part of this. We're building something. I just do think that matters. I think good players want to play with good players. I think they want to believe that they're going to a place that's going to win. And I think when you get this kind of momentum, again, you got to make sure it counts in the fall. But when you're getting transfers like they're getting, high-profile transfers, and then you've got a class right now very early on that's ranked top 5 that might finish, you know, top 10 or 12, that feeds itself. I think these kind of things feed itself, and they can get some players in here.
Are we going to go hang out with him sometime?
Travis Hunter? Yeah, let's do it, man. He lives, about, I think, 10 or 12 miles from my house where I live up here. I mean, I hang out. I see him getting his car every day before school as I'm walking my dog. I find an excuse to be in his neighborhood. That's not creepy, right?
Black Tahoe or garnet-colored Tahoe?
Oh, for him?
Yeah.
Garnet-colored, for sure, with the Florida State flags on the window.
Okay.
Like old school, like 1997.
Yeah,
he's right. He's not about that sticker life.
No, okay.
He wants to risk it like my dad. My dad would literally lose, I would say, 4 a year. He'd forget he'd have it on the window and roll it down for what. It's not like he smoked or spit, but he'd always just roll down his window, and 4 times a year, there goes the flag on 85 or 75, just falling off in the middle of the highway.
My buddy has the magnet, like, on my way to see the Noles.
Ooh, nice.
That's what you got to do.
Honk at him, give him a little chop. Yeah, man. I miss those days.
Florida State currently has more 5-stars in the 2022 class than LSU, Clemson, and Notre Dame combined.
Yeah.
You like that? I mean,
guys, it's happening. It's like happening. That. But in all seriousness, there is the Enzo Armalas kid. I think he's releasing a top 7 this week that Florida State's trying to get in there on? You want to be in that top seven? If you can't be in the top one unless you're in the top seven. And then Marvin Jones Jr., who again, he needs to, they need, that just has to happen. But so there are still some guys, a lot of them obviously, that they can make a run at that could make this recruiting class maybe one, especially if you can keep Hunter, man. I don't know why, I shouldn't even project that. Let's just assume he's a solid commit, which he definitely appears to be. If, you know, this could be the class that's like the 2010 class that starts it.
He's the LaMarcus Joyner?
Could be. Yeah, right? Telvin was in that class. I mean, there were some really good players in that class, obviously. But, yeah, he could be the LaMarcus Joyner of that class.
I think that's that convinces
other players that it's okay to come back to Florida State again. They're going to have good players, and we can win there.
I mean, I don't want to be sacrilegious, but I think maybe in the here and now, like as high school, like emerging high school seniors, he might be higher projected than LaMarcus, man.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, the size, right? He's a little bit bigger than LaMarcus was. But yeah, man, if he had, let's just say he has LaMarcus's career, Florida State will be very happy.
We'll take it. And then I think Julian Armella, who's a legacy, is also supposed to be dropping a top seven. Let's see here. LaMarcus was the 14th overall rated prospect when it was all said and done in the 2010 class.
Who was number one?
And right now, Travis Hunter is 12th. Number one all in the class of 2010. Drum roll, please. Yeah, my internet.
Oh, as
just not being, it's just not very internet-y. Or it's, wow, that's really disappointing, huh?
It is incredibly disappointing. Weren't you right there?
Well, yeah, I have to click on some. Ooh. You would never guess it. I'm glad I brought it up. Look at all these guys. Like, Keenan Allen, number five. What a great wide receiver. Just can't stay healthy.
Yeah.
Ooh. Wow. 2010, not the best. Number one player is Ronald Powell, five-star defensive end out of Moreno Valley, California. Went to the Gators.
Okay.
Chantrell Henderson, who I think bounced between Miami and Southern Cal.
Yeah.
Never even heard of this guy. Kyle Prater was number three. Sharif Floyd, who went to the Gators, interior lineman. I think he went to the league. I think he was a high pick.
Yeah.
Fourth. Robert Woods, who I think is still catching passes in the NFL for the Rams.
Yeah,
sixth.
For the Rams, right? For Matt Stafford now, I guess.
Yeah. Dominic Easley, seventh. Can't even pronounce number eight. O-Train?
You just, the O-Train.
He went to UCLA. Don't even know.
Okay.
Derek Rogers, number nine. From Calhoun, Georgia, went to Tennessee, and then Marcus Lattimore, number 10.
Okay, all right. So LaMarcus was the highest on the for Florida State that year?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. I'm going to love just to see some NFL All-Pro buried here at the bottom. It's probably not a good thing. I'm not taking shots at our guys at Rivals. It's a tough thing to do this, but it's crazy when you scroll down and you just kind of see guys like, oh, this guy was ranked here, and this is what his NFL career ended up being. Like Anthony Barr, 50th. Anthony Barr is like an all-pro linebacker.
Yeah, but also when you think about it, though, if you're ranked the 50th best player in the United States out of 25,000 players.
49 guys ahead of you, though, man.
But still, that's like the top of the line. Like, it can't be better than that. I mean, no, from 50 to 41 or 50 to 21 or 50 to 11, it's all semantics. It's all by hairs. But if you're ranked 50th in the country, you know, you're getting accolades.
Yeah, but these guys, I mean,
yeah, they're gonna miss. They're gonna miss. I think it's better now than it was then. But yeah, they're always gonna miss. That's the thing about recruiting rankings. It's crazy. The Gators had three guys in the top eight.
Christian,
and I don't
even
think that counts. Matt Elam. What I think that was Matt Elam's class.
It was. You're right. It was Matt Elam. Matt Elam came in at number 25.
So he was a Florida State guy until he went and played in San Antonio and then flipped.
Christian Jones was 20th.
Yep. Christian Green was in there somewhere.
61st.
Okay.
I feel like
Jeff Luke was in there somewhere.
He was in the 40s. Come on. I can't see. I just always love seeing that guy like at the 80s. You're like, oh, this guy was ranked 80th and all these other guys were ahead of him. But like, maybe they didn't do all that bad this time around.
Yeah, it sounds like they did all right. Yeah. And again, you know, you win some, you lose some. But, yeah, I mean, think about Florida. They signed three of the best. I remember when that class happened, and they thought it was like one of the best defensive classes that had ever been signed. Yeah. And it turned out, I mean, you had at least four or five NFL dudes there with Elam and Floyd and Easley. Floyd,
yeah.
But I mean, what it didn't add any wins.
I know.
You know, they were 4-8 that class when they were juniors and seniors. So there's more to it. It's more to it than just high recruiting rankings too. But they very much help. So, and again, the point being, Florida State does have some definite momentum going now when it comes to this. And it would really help if at some point there can be in-home visits again. But as it is, they have a pretty good amount of momentum going with the transfers and the energy around the program. You just hope it keeps up and that they don't fall on their face in the fall.
Man, I don't think it's in-home. It's let these kids be able to come on official visits.
That too. Absolutely. Yeah.
That Nico kid was here last week, I think. He went to Gainesville and then Tallahassee. And then when he announced, he was back in Tallahassee.
So they flew back to Tallahassee for the announcement, right?
Or drove. Yeah, they got back somehow.
Well, we assume he flew.
I would assume he flew.
Man.
Family of like six in the photo.
Yep. Yep.
Grandma, dad, and a mom.
Yep. Girlfriend, aunt, flew them all just for an Instagram announcement.
No-blooded. So,
again, also, I feel like you're not doing that if you're short on cash. I feel like this is a good – it's smart. I don't know if Coburn went to Norvell and was like, look, we got to start recruiting rich kids. I mean, at least sprinkle in a few. We'll name the facility after the kid. We got to start getting some people with money because apparently he's got some money. So maybe that was, you know, Norvell.
I thought we were going to go with he's so dedicated. He loves this place so much that he – came back twice. I wasn't trying to.
Oh, no. I was amazed that he flew in just for an Instagram announcement that he could have done from his kitchen.
Well, it's crazy because he's getting a car and he's doing it live on Instagram. He's in the backseat of a car and everybody in the car is quiet. You're like, where is he going? Like, is he driving to the top of some mountain peak in Arizona and right. he's going to, like, you know, free dive off
is
of
Is he
it?
Driving to Chubba Purdy's house?
Yeah. Like,
to throw a football through the window?
And then all of a sudden you just see like a shrub and you see like the, and it's like, I'm like, that looks from, and then it's him just sitting on a bench and I'm like, that's familiar. I'm like, he's in Tallahassee again.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
And it was live, right?
Live.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, Nico. All right, buddy.
All right. On the downer note, what happened to the basketball team? You were there. Somebody pointed out, I think, that Florida State has now moved to 1-5 in Atlanta since you've joined warchant.com, Corey. So I don't know if you want to. Eskimo Randy, it's titled The Corey Clark Curse. In the last 6 years, FSU football and basketball have combined 1-5 in the city of Atlanta. I have to believe these poor results are connected to Corey Clark in some way.
And I'm always at them, too. Is that true? 1-5? I know they beat them 2 years ago. They beat the tar out of them here. But yeah, I guess that's it. Yeah, remember that game? Well, you might not. Florida State was like six in the country,
yes.
And Georgia Tech was awful.
Yes.
And Florida State lost by like 100.
Yes.
It was just the craziest thing. The Okogie kid scored 35 points. Yeah. Colorado's I guess that was. It was a bad day, man. It was a bad day. I thought Leonard summed it up pretty well. It was funny after the game. You know, people. Yeah, as is always the case when you lose a game. All the questions are negative, which is to be understood. But also, like, what happened here? What happened here? What did you guys not do? Like, why were you so bad? Or why the turnovers? And he's like, look, you know, sometimes you just have to say the other team about played you. They played with more urgency. We felt like we were stuck in mud. Our game plan wasn't to just dribble the ball, air out of the ball, and not penetrate and kick, but we just didn't do it. Basically giving them all the credit. Like, Alvarado was really good, and he was. He was the best player on the floor. And you had – but that's going to happen. You don't want to – and what his point was, which is a good one, and it's what all coaches are thinking about, is you want to just chalk it up. Not that you don't learn from it and get better, but you don't want it to hurt your confidence. Mm. It's just – sometimes you have a bad 40 minutes. Sometimes the Lakers lose to the Hornets. It just happens. It's basketball.
Yep.
But you don't want it to turn into a problem. Where all of a sudden is cocky, not even cocky is not the right word, as confident as you were 48 hours ago about you being the best team in the country, now you don't want to be to the point where you're like, man, I hope we can hang with Boston College. Like, you've still got to carry yourself like that was just a bad blip was a bad game. They played better than we did. And we move on and get better, and we'll be a lot better the next time we play, which is usually what happens with this program in recent years. They don't typically have one loss turn into three. They do a good job of rebounding. But, yeah, they were awful, man. The offense was a train wreck. It was all, I mean, 11, 20 turnovers and 11 and a half, just nuts. And missed dunks and missed free throws and essentially airballed three-pointers. Yeah, it wasn't great.
They play at 9 o'clock on Tuesday?
Yeah, man. Aren't you excited?
Good gosh.
It's a triple header on the ACC network for the folks that get it. They got a 5-er, a 7, and a 9-er. It's perfect, though, because Brady has a game at 8 o'clock, so I should be back in time to at least watch most of the game. And watch all of his game. Which
what
is
time is his game?
8.
So are we
but gonna they're
do
running
a live
clocks.
Show?
Well, yeah, we can do the live show at 5. Or 6. We can even do it at 6.
Yeah, like, yeah,
I got to be at the gym at 7:55. They're not allowed to go in until they're actually playing.
Okay.
You know,
by the
for
way,
COVID reasons.
The great part of the thread is that there was a couple people replied, and our guy Mark in Naples comes to defend your honor. It's awesome. It's like, he lives in Gwinnett County, which is not Atlanta. Why have to beat up on my man Corey, who's immensely entertaining and a walking encyclopedia of FSU knowledge? It's great.
Thank you, Mark. I didn't take it as... There you go. I always need people in my corner. The more, the merrier. I didn't take that comment as him attacking me. I think it was done in jest.
It was.
But I'm always for people having my back, even if the person isn't being mean to me. Still have my back. Go on the offensive when you're defending me. That's what I need. But, yeah, look, man, Malik Osborne was awful, and he's not an awful basketball player. But my man, he played 19 minutes and was a minus 13, which means when he was on the court, they got outscored by 13 points. He was 0 for 6 with 1 point. And Wyatt Wilkes played more minutes than both MJ Walker and Scotty Barnes. And that's not a recipe for success. Wyatt Wilkes has a role in this team. I'm not saying he doesn't. He's had some really big moments. But, you know, he can't lead your team in minutes and you'd be effective. Because you saw at the end of the game, he's just not what you need defensively when you're trying to get pressure stops. And you know, but again, that's mainly because Anthony Polite's not available yet, but when they get him back, you hope sooner rather than later, maybe even this week, that changes the whole dynamic of the team, in my opinion, because that guy's just, he's an indispensable dude that they need. But how about my man Raekwon Gray?
19?
He had 19. Yeah.
Come on,
yeah. 8 rebounds.
Some.
Yeah. I'm actually, when people listen to this, there will be a story going up on Raekwon Gray on Warchant just about, you know, the fact that he redshirted, and there's not many people that are like him. Like, he's one of the better players in the conference now that redshirted.
He's Draymond Green, says Seth Greenberg.
Yeah, he's, you know, plus he's bigger, but yeah, he's very similar skill sets. I looked it up, Aslan. This will be what we leave you with today because I don't want to be all negative on the basketball team. They're still 10-3. They're still going to be ranked. Virginia lost to Virginia Tech. Virginia Tech went on like a 19-0 run in that game. So Florida State's still very much in contention for the one seed in the ACC if they beat who they're supposed to beat and push this bad game behind them. But Raekwon, I looked it up because that's what I do. In games this season, he's led the team in scoring twice. He's led them in rebounds 8 times. He's led them in assists 5 times. He's led them in blocks 2 times. And he's led them in steals 6 times. That's crazy. Like, blocks, steals, assists, points, and rebounds. He's led the team in all of those categories multiple times. It's not like, and MJ Walker's great. It's not like he's leading the team in blocks. But Raekwon just does every, and he's very good on defense, too. He really has learned it on defense. It's just, it's really pretty impressive what he's become. Because, I mean, we didn't know what he was going to be when he got to Florida State. And if you're usually, when you're good, when you're this good, you don't get redshirted, but he did. He even said he didn't handle it really well at the beginning, and Stan Jones said he didn't handle it really well at the beginning, but he got better as the season went on, and now he's become, again, I said Anthony Polite's indispensable. Raekwon Gray is definitely indispensable. That guy's just a difference maker, man, on both ends of the court, and he's only a junior. He's technically got 2 more years left if he wants them, so it's just good to see, man. It's cool. It's another cool aspect of this program. When you see, yes, they get ones and duns now, and they're fun too, clearly. But it's also cool to see the Polites and the Grays and the Luke Lauks and the people like that that starts, you know, pretty low and then end up being indispensable players on good teams. So anyway, just something to chew on, Aslan.
I should ask Google this, but I don't know how my internet goes. They're going to have a 2021 basketball tournament, like ACC. I know they're going to have an NCAA. Are we having a conference tournament?
Yes, that's the plan.
Okay.
So I think I read on Twitter on Sunday that the JW Marriott in Indianapolis has been completely booked by the NCAA tournament for March Madness. And I think it said 26 teams are going to be there just in that one hotel. So what they're going to do in Indianapolis is essentially create a bubble, which is going to be something unbelievable to think about. But there's going to be a bubble because some of those teams are going to have to stay there for 3 weeks, four of them anyway, or 2.5 weeks. But for the ACC tournament, yes, the plan is to still have one. But I also saw talk, some of the commissioners in these Power 5 conferences, or just Division I conferences in general, are maybe going to amend their tournaments and shorten them. So maybe only the top 8 teams go, or the top 4 teams go.
Just don't do it then. The whole point of doing the tournament is so that that 12 seed can sneak into the tournament.
And it so rarely happens. And like if you're in the A-Sun, or the Mountain West, even, like, why do it to yourself? Why, if you're a one bid league, like I can't think of the name of the
Horizon.
Like Colgate. Yeah, you go, sure, Horizon. And you have one team that won the league. Then why just for one season anyway? You're not going to make any money off the tournament in the Horizon League. So for one season, let your regular season winner, who I've always thought should go anyway, because they earned it over the long haul as opposed to a team that gets hot for 3 days, but let them go and represent you in the NCAA tournament. And don't have
That's the beauty of the tournament.
Yeah,
I would
part
say,
of the allure is that everybody has a chance to get to the NCAA tournament when postseason starts. But this year's different, man. I don't know if you want conference, because what Leonard was asked about this on his the coaches teleconference last week, and he laughed it off. But what if one of your players tests positive while you're in Greensboro? Do you then miss the NCAA tournament because you played in a meaningless conference tournament?
Yeah,
do you want to risk that?
If you're Power 5, whatever 6, I guess, with whatever the Big East is these days, like I don't think there's any point of doing a conference tournament, man. The resumes are made. You don't need to get that. If you win 2 games, you're on the 2 line. No, man. There's enough data. Figure it out.
Yeah. It's developing. I don't think they, as we all have seen the last 3 months, the NCAA basketball committee or whoever makes these decisions hasn't really been on top of things. So they're going to figure it out when they get closer to March. I have no confidence that there will be a guideline for all these conference tournaments. I think some conferences will have them, some won't. Some will shorten them, some won't. And we'll just go from there.
And then, actually, before we do go, we spoke to Meat on Friday, baseball.
Mm-hmm.
Got a pretty good outfield.
Oh, all right.
He says top 3, he thinks. Or maybe he said top 5. Maybe it was top 5, he said. I think he said
top five. What?
Outfields in the nation. Reese is healthy. Right. Reese is good to go.
Yeah.
Ribby Martin's Cabell. Back. Cabell, he was saying, made some joke that Elijah's cost him a lot of money because he keeps hitting balls, into the parking lot and they can't find him. And apparently they've got like 15 pitchers that they like. He just likes everybody. Everybody.
Yeah, they're good, man. They're going to be, I think Baseball America has them 9th. Some other outlets have them like in the teens. But, they have a chance, again, like every year, they have a chance to go to Omaha. Cabell is the one. Like, he seemed to be taking strides last year before it got shut down. There has never – I promise, I know all about Florida State baseball. There has never been a guy who produces more power, like power per inch or whatever, power per square inch. Like, remember Drago when he was hitting the – when he was hitting the machine?
Yeah.
And a normal man is like 800, and he was 2250 or whatever. That's kind of what it is here with this guy, man. Like, he doesn't look like a guy that hits 470 foot bombs, but he is.
Yeah.
And he was a much better hitter the first 17 games of last year than he had been his first year. And if he can continue to grow, he could be he's a high round pick. He can run. He hits the bejesus out of the ball when he hits it. If he can get the swing and miss out of there. Yeah, it's got a chance. Reese Albert, we know what he is. Robbie Martin, we know what he is. It's got a chance to be a good, really good team. They just got to field it in the infield, man.
Matt Nelson, he says Matt Nelson's the only guy who's got a job locked up.
Yeah, that guy can. He's really good behind the plate.
So that guy's really good. They said Nander, I think they've got him batting right. Righty now, saying, you know, instead of making him jack of all trades, master of none, I think is what he said. We're just going to focus on making him bat from the right side.
That's so smart.
Yeah. I want to go to Omaha, Corey. I want to go to Omaha.
I know, man. Me and you both. Bring Brady back. Get the whole band back together. Stephanie can go on the road trip with us again. We literally played Omaha by, what was it, the Counting Crows, that song, for an hour straight driving into Omaha. Stephanie, I, and Brady, to the point where he's like, please, no more. Like, Brady, look, and every time we saw a sign, like Omaha, 44 miles, we'd start it up again. Omaha, 22 miles. And by the time we actually got into Omaha, because he kept asking, he was 10, when are we going to be there? Are we there yet? Yeah. By the time we rolled in, he was asleep. Yeah. So we really had to turn it up to wake him up so he could hear it.
You should have played the old College World Series theme song, Omaha, by some guy named Chris or something out there.
Oh, yeah. No, I don't know.
Yeah, feels so good to breathe the air back here. It's a good song.
Seminole wins better than that.
You're right. All right, we're done for the day. We'll be back with a live show and then Rainy Express later on in the week. And maybe we'll hang out in Gwinnett this week. We'll see how that goes, Corey. That'll be fun.
Yeah, man. Yeah, let's do it.
All right. Stay connected to warchant.com. The ultimate Seminole sports source. Signing day is Wednesday. Michael Langs has got everything covered on the PRB, the premium recruiting board. He's Corey. I'm Aslan. Thanks for listening to Wake Up Warchant, presented by Zaxby's. Indescribably. You want to say it? Good.
Warchant.com is the ultimate inside source for FSU football and recruiting. And now you can get in on the action for free for an entire month. Warchant.com is offering a risk-free 30-day trial subscription. Get full access to the number one website covering the Seminoles just by entering the promo code WARCHANT30. That's WARCHANT30. Sign up and get in on the world's most active FSU message boards. Receive breaking news, stories from our award-winning staff, plus get exclusive interviews and videos. Just enter the promo code WARCHANT30. Warchant.com, your ultimate Seminole sports source.